بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. I seek refuge in Allah from Shaitan the wretched one. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I begin in the name of Allah the compassionate the most merciful. الحمد لله رب العالمين. All praise is due for Allah, the Lord of the universe, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the compassionate, the most merciful, Maliki Yawmiddin, Master of the Day of Judgment, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'een, only you do we worship, and from only you do we seek help. Ihdina As-Sirata Al-Mustaqeem, guide us along the straight path. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, the path of those whom you favored, غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين, not the path of those upon whom your wrath fell, nor of those who went astray. آمين. O Allah, accept our dua. This is brief translation of Surah Al-Fatiha, which we recite in our Salah every day, in every Salah, 5 times a day. Today we want to talk about a little bit of the tafsir and meaning of this Surah. First of all, number one, the virtues of this Surah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once said to a Sahabi, Abu Sa'id ibn al-Mu'alla, remind me to tell you of the greatest surah of the Quran before I exit the masjid. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was about to exit the masjid, Abu Sa'id reminded him, Ya Rasulullah, can you please tell me the greatest surah of the Quran? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Surah Al-Fatiha. هي السبع المثاني والقرآن العظيم الذي أوتيته. Surah Fatiha is the 7 most repeated ayat and the Quran Azim which I was given. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked a similar question to Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu. Do you know which is the greatest surah of the Quran? And Ubay ibn Ka'b replied, Allahu wa Rasuluhu A'lam. And Rasulullah asked him again. And then second time, Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu said, Surah Al-Fatiha. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam patted on his chest and he said, Li ahlikal ilmu wa bal munzir. So Surah Fatiha is the greatest surah of the Quran. And because of that, we have been instructed to repeat it, recite it in every salah. Surah Al-Fatiha has many names. Number one, Surah Al-Fatiha, the opening, because it opens the Quran. It is the first surah of the Quran. Surah Ummil Quran, the mother of the Quran, because everything that is in the Quran is summarized into Surah Al-Fatiha. So it's called, it's named the mother of the Quran. How is that? Well, the Quran consists of aqaid, beliefs, and Quran consists of guidance, hidayat, and Quran consists of stories of the previous nations, the good people and the bad people. And all this is summarized in Surah Al-Fatiha. Aqaid are in the opening verses where Allah is mentioned as Rabbul Alameen, Rahman, Rahim, Maliki Yawmiddin. His existence, His oneness, His attributes, His sifat are mentioned. And then our humbleness and duty is shown to Allah that we will abide by all the ahkam that are in the Quran by saying, Iyaka Na'budu. And wa iyyaka nasta'een, we only seek help from you. Guidance is sought from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for sirati mustaqeem. And the previous nations are mentioned in ghayril maghdubi alayhim wa laddallin. So So it consists, it summarizes the context of contents of the Quran. That's why it's known as Surah Umm al-Quran. It's also called Surah al-Shifa. Qazi Bayzawi rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned 14 names of this surah. Among them is Surah al-Shifa, Surah al-Shafiya, Surah al-Kafiya as well. This is because it's known as Surah al-Shifa. It gives shifa, it brings cure to a person. And this is in the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, wherein Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu was on a journey with some of the Sahaba, and they came upon an area where the leader of the community was bit by a snake, and they ask these people if you can do ruqya on our leader. And Abu Sa'id Khudri radiallahu anhu went, and he kept on reciting Surah Al-Fatiha and blowing on the affected person once, twice, three times, four times, five, six, seven. When he blew the seventh time, the person stood up from his sickness as though he was released from chains. So when they came back and they reported this incident, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, how did you know that Surah Al-Fatiha is ruqya as well? You did the right thing. So Surah Al-Shifa as well. This is why when we go to hospital to visit a sick person, rather than just sitting there and busying in other conversations, we should read Surah Al-Fatiha and blow on the person. Inshallah, cure and shifa is in Allah's hands. Allah will give shifa and cure. So it's known as Surah Al-Shifa, Surah Al-Shafiya as well, other names as well. It's the greatest surah of the Quran. It starts off with Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due for Allah, the Lord of the universe. Alhamdulillah, the Alif Lam is for istighraq, which means it covers all praises. Whether the praise we understand, we don't understand, we hear, or the praise is related to Allah Himself or to other things in the universe, like the sun is very bright, the moon is very shiny, and the stars are beautiful, and anything else, human beings, creations, to the extent that other things made by Allah, made by the creation, like a Mercedes car or a Rolls Royce, we say this is a beautiful car, how nice it is. Then in reality, all this praise returns to Allah. Because the sun, moon, if they are beautiful, they were beautified by Allah. And the creation made by Allah. And if the Mercedes car and the good things, good houses, then the person who made that car or that thing was given the brains by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ability and the power by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tools and the material by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the end, all praise returns and refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is Alhamdulillah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes being praised. And everybody likes praise, but nobody likes praise more than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If this praise is for fakhr and takabbur within human beings, then this pride and haughtiness is no good. But generally, if someone is, praised for some good ability, good quality, and shown gratitude, is thanked for his efforts, then he likes it, that Alhamdulillah, people appreciated my effort. So when human beings like praise and, being shown gratitude, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of the universe. He likes praise. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La ahada ahabba ilayhi al-midhatu min Allah. Walidhalika wa'adallahu al-jannah. There is none who likes praise more than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised Jannah. So people praise him and try to gain Jannah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَفْضَلُ الذِّكْرِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَفْضَلُ الدُّعَاءِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. The best form of dhikr and remembrance is La ilaha illallah, and the best form of dua is Alhamdulillah. This means when you say Alhamdulillah, then in effect you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His bounties and His grace. Because you know, when you praise someone who is of a high status and that person is understanding, he will know that this person is praising me because he needs something from me. أَذْكُرُ حَاجَتِي أَمْ قَدْ كَفَانِي حَيَاءُكَ إِنَّ شِيمَتَكَ الْحَيَاءُ. You know, in front of the greats, we don't need to mention our needs. We just say a few words of ta'rif and gratitude, and they understand and they give. So Allah is Allah. When we say Allah, all praise is for you, and we show our gratitude. O Allah, I am grateful to you. I do your shukr. Alhamdulillah. Allahumma laka alhamdu wa laka shukru. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands that my servant needs me and he needs something from me, and he fulfills our needs. So saying Alhamdulillah is also a form of asking and begging from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah likes praise. In one hadith it has come that one sahabi said the word, Ya Rabbi laka alhamdu kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhik wa li azim sultani. So the malaika tried to write the reward, but they were unable to write the reward because Allah was giving so much reward for that they could not write it. So they returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they said, Ya Allah, your servant has praised you from the depth of his heart with some beautiful words, and we are unable to write the sawab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, what did he say? And they repeated the words, Ya Rabbi laka alhamdu kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhik wa li azim sultanik. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, okay, if you can't write the reward and the thawab which I am giving him, then just write the words which he has uttered. I will reward him myself on the day of Qiyamah. So, alhamd and praise is extremely beloved in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should always glorify and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And alhamdu rasu shukri. مَا شَكَرَ اللَّهَ عَبْدٌ لَمْ يَحْمِدُهُ. This is one hadith which Qazi Bayzawi has narrated, that hamd is the head of shukr. A person who does not praise Allah has not done shukr of Allah. So if we want to be thankful and grateful to Allah, then we have to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more we praise Him, the more He will be happy and He will bless us more. لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you do my shukr and show gratitude to me, then I will give you more, is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is why Allah started Suratul Fatiha. Allah opened the Quran with hamd and praise. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Allah is the Lord of the universe. Rabb is from rububiyyat. Rabba yurabbi tarbiyatan means to nurture someone, to look after someone, to bring someone up. So Allah is our murabbi. He is our khaliq, He is our malik, and He is the one who protects us, takes care of us, and He is our rabb. He is our malik, He is our owner. So Allah is our rabb. This is why you know, when we make dua, many duas start with the word rabb. Rabbana ighfir lana dhunubana, rabbana zalamna anfusana, rabbi ighfir warham wa anta khairur rahimin, rabbi irhamhuma kama rabbayani saghira, rabbana la tuakhidhna in nasina wa akhtana, rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana, rabbana la taj'alna fitnatan lilqawmi adh-dhalimin. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes this title of rabb when we humble ourselves before Him and we say, You are my Rabb and You are my patron, You are my guardian, You are my protector, I want You to look after me. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this attribute over here, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. He is the Rabb of the universe. And Al-Alameen is plural of Alam, and Alam means world. And the world, Allah Pak has created many worlds, the worlds of Malaika, the worlds of jinns, world of human beings, the world of animals, the world of birds, the world of fishes, and the planets and universe. These are all alams. So all the awalims and all the creation, all the worlds are under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is Rabbul Alameen, He is the creator, He is the Murabbi, and He is the one who looks after everyone and everything. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, He is the compassionate, the most merciful. Ar-Rahman is ism of mubalagha, which means, you know, to express something in huge number. So Ar-Rahman means Allah's rahmah and mercy is limitless. He is the only one who is Rahman. And this is why nobody else has been given this attribute of Rahman. Rahman is a special attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why when Allah mentioned, you know, istiwa ala al-arsh, He said, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa. Rahman, the only one, He is the one who ascended the throne. And, in one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned the dua, Rahman al-dunya wal-akhirati wa rahimahuma, anta tarhamuna farhamna bi rahmatin tughnina biha an rahmati man siwak. So Rahman, because His Rahma encompasses every creation that is beneath the Arsh and the throne. And Arsh is the largest creation of Allah. And this is why Rahman was connected to Al Arsh. And from there, His Rahma descends and comes down upon the whole creation which is beneath the Arsh, the throne, including the Malaika, the jinns, the human beings, and the birds and the fishes and everything that Allah has created. His Rahmat covers everything. And in Surah Bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ اِدْعُوا اللَّهَ وَاِدْعُوا الرَّحْمَانَ اَيَّمَّا تَدْعُوا فَلَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى. Say to these people, call upon Allah or call upon Rahman. Whosoever you call, by whichever name you call, He has the most beautiful of names. So we call Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Kareem, Ya Hayyu, Ya Qayyum, Ya Zal Jalal wal Ikram. So we call upon Allah with beautiful names. Ar-Rahman, Allah loves this name. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, started Surah Al-Fatiha with this attribute of Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, the most merciful. Both are given. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have, sufficed by Ar-Rahman, but Allah wanted to include Ar-Rahim as well, because Rahim is most of the time connected to the Rahmat of this dunya. And Rahman is connected to the Rahmats of Akhirat. So to show the Rahmat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that covers in this dunya over the creation, Allah brought the attribute of Rahim as well, that Allah's Rahmah covers everything from Arsh to Farsh and from dunya to Akhirat. And especially in this Akhirat, in this dunya, Allah is Rahim with you, He is merciful with you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself has said, كَتَبَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ الرَّحْمَةِ. Rabb has fixed and written upon Himself Rahmat, that He deals with Rahmah more than His Ghadab. This is why Allah Pak has written on a piece of paper and kept it near the Arsh, on which it is engraved, إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَزَبِي. My Rahmah supersedes and encompasses my Ghazab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always showering His rahmah and mercy upon us, but ghazab and anger and wrath only falls now and then, sometimes, when people exceed the limits in transgression, in fisq and fujur and kufr and shirk. That's when Allah's ghazab comes. But we experience Allah's rahmah every day, every moment, every breath we take with afiyat is a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Allah is Rahman, Allah is Rahim. And this is why whenever we start to do something, we say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And we do, this is an ayat of the Quran, Innahu min Sulaiman wa innahu Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have, put some other attributes here, Bismillahir Azizil Jabbar. But no, Bismillahir Zil Jalal wal Ikram. No, Allah didn't use those attributes from 99 names. Allah chose Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim to show His Rahmat and His mercy. I read in one book some incidents about, you know, reverts. And one revert says, I studied Islam and, you know, I understood everything from Tawheed, oneness of Allah, from Malaika, the angels of Allah, the books of Allah, and the messengers of Allah, and life after death, Jannah, Jahannam, you know, rewards, retribution, everything I understood. But one thing I couldn't figure out, and that was Taqdeer, fate, destiny. Why has Allah kept Taqdeer, everything in His hand? So I kept on studying. One day I sat down, I prayed to Allah, please Allah, you know, help me. I know everything, but why can't I understand this? And He says, I pondered over Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. That whenever we commence anything, we say, in the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful. So when I pondered over this, I thought, oh, Allah Pak has taught us this to tell us that there is this some rahmat and mercy in taqdeer as well. Allah Pak has kept fate and destiny, and in there is some rahmat and mercy for us. Because if there was no taqdeer, we would have gone wild and we would have done whatever we, you know, wanted, and the whole world would have been in chaos. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept everything in His hand. He has given us some free will, by a little bit of free will, by which, you know, we can go about our daily lives. But otherwise, many things Allah has fixed, like, you know, our life, lifespan, our time of going, death, our rizq, and our, you know, these things Allah has fixed for us. So there is some rahmat and mercy in there for us, and gave me the answer to my query. And I said, even if I don't understand the reality and the haqiqat of taqdeer, but I know that Allah is Rahman and Rahim, so there is some rahmat and mercy in taqdeer as well. And he says, I embraced Islam and declared the shahada, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. So Allah is Rahman, Rahim, everything is rahmat, mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maliki yawmiddin, Allah is the owner of the Day of Judgment. Day of Judgment, Yawmuddin, Deen, Dana Yadinu Deenan means, it has many meanings. It means Ita'at and Farma Bardari and obedience as well. It also means to repay. So Yawmuddin, the Day of Repayment. A person will be repaid for everything he did, good or bad. So that day is a huge day, is a mighty day, the Day of Judgment. It is the longest day a person can think of. For some, it will be as long as 50,000 years. For others, it will be as long as 1,000 years. For others, it will be some, it will be short. For the good people, it will be very short day. It will pass very swiftly. And that day is يوم القيامة. لا أقسم بيوم القيامة ولا أقسم بالنفس اللوامة. The Day of Qiyamah is mighty, huge, so huge and so mighty that Allah took a qasam of it by saying لا أقسم بيوم القيامة. I am taking a qasam of the Day of Qiyamah. It is a huge day. It is an ajeeb day, amazing day, the Day of Judgment, where everybody will be judged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself. That is Yawmuddin. And Allah is the owner and the master of that day. In one qiraat, here comes Maliki Yawmuddin, and Malik means the king of the Day of Judgment. So both are right, Malik as well and Malik as well. Malik means owner, possessor, and they both mean that on that day, no one will own anything for anyone. In Surah Al-Infitar, Allah said, يَوْمَ لَا تَمْلِكُ نَفْسٌ لِنَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَالْأَمْرُ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلَّهِ. It is a day in which no one will own anything for anyone, and all affairs will belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah will be the sole owner on that day. Nobody will own anything, any building, any zameen or land or any property. Nothing will be with anyone. Oh, the only thing a person will have on that day will be his deeds, good or bad. His books will be presented to him, and he will be held to account for whatever he had done during the lifetime. So that is a huge day. Allah is the owner of that day, and no one will own anything. And He is the king. In Surah Az-Zumar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ. Allah will subhanahu wa ta'ala will call out on that day, to whom belongs the kingdom today? Then Allah himself will reply, the kingdom belongs to Allah, the alone, the subduer. So the mulk and the bashahat and the domain and the kingdom of that day, there will be no Fir'aun, no Haman, no Namrud, no kings and no queens on that day. Everybody will be every man, woman for him, herself. وَكُلُّهُمْ آتِيهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَرْدًا. Everyone will come alone. There will be no protocols, no khadims, no attendants, no one. Every man, Fir'aun will be himself, Namrud will be himself, Haman will be himself, and all the kings and queens will be alone on that day. Allah will be the king of that day, and he will be the master of the day of judgment. So, in these three opening verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned that all praise belongs to Allah, because He is Allah, the creator, the sustainer, and the Rabb of the universe, and He is Rahman, and He is Rahim, He is the owner of the day of judgment. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described Himself to us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moves on to say, to teach us to say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. People, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us to show our obedience and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. O Allah, we have now recognized you, we know who you are. You are Rabbul Alameen, you are Rahman, you are Rahim, you are Malik Yawmiddin. We declare our servitude to you. Only you do we worship, and from only you do we seek help. Since you are such, then you should be worshipped, and help should be sought from you. So Iyyaka Na'budu, we only worship you, we don't want to worship anyone else. Only you do we worship. Iyyaka na'budu. Iyyaka na'budu means na'buduka wala na'budu ghayraka. We worship you and we don't worship anyone else. No idol, no sun, no moon, no star, no worship of anyone else. Today people worship many things. Some people worship football stars, cricket stars. They bow down before them, and you know, they humble themselves to the utmost humility. What is the meaning of ibadat? Qazi Bayzawi rahmatullah said, al-ibadatu aqsa ghayatil khudu'i wa tadhallul. Ibadat means the utmost humility and humbleness, and lowering yourself before someone is worship. This is bowing down, this is prostrating in front of someone, and you know, spending your wealth for the pleasure of someone, and staying hungry and thirsty for the sake of someone, going round the house of someone. This is form of ibadat. And all these ibadats, whether they are salat or zakat or sawm or hajj, are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, O Allah, we will worship you only and no one else. We will sacrifice animals for qurbani on Eidul Azha for your name only and not for anyone else. When we sacrifice an animal, slaughter an animal, we will take your name, Bismillahi Allahu Akbar, because you created that animal and you gave us the ability and the power over it to eat the meat of that animal. So, you know, we take the name of Allah, Bismillahi Allahu Akbar. And when we say Bismillahi Allahu Akbar, the animal also gets a soothing feeling, and you know, it knows the Creator, and it humbles itself before the Creator as well, and it knows that I have been created for this purpose. So, it humbles itself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, only you do we worship, O Allah, and وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, from only you do we seek help. نَسْتَعِينَ, إِسْتَعَانَ يَسْتَعِينُ means to seek help. So, O Allah, we need your help. Now, seeking help should be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is, you know, with regards to matters which are only in Allah's hands. We seek that help from Allah alone. Example, giving children, giving job, removing problems, calamities, musibats, it is in Allah's hands. So we should always turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِحْرِصْ عَلَى مَا يَنْفَعُكْ وَاسْتَعِينْ بِاللَّهِ وَلَا تَعْجَزْ. Seek help from Allah. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, the young boy who was only about 12-13, he said, Ya ghulam, inni wa'allimuka kalimat. احفظ الله يحفظك احفظ الله تجده تجاهك إذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله واعلم أن الأمة لو اجتمعت على أن ينفعوك بشيء لم ينفعوك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله لك ولو اجتمعت على أن يضروك بشيء لم يضروك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله عليك رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف. In one riwayat, there is addition of وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ النَّصْرَ مَعَ الصَّبْرِ وَأَنَّ الْفَرَاجَ مَعَ الْكَرْبِ وَأَنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. So in the wordings, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. When you ask, ask from Allah. When you seek help from Allah. And know that if the whole world was to get together and to benefit you, they cannot benefit you with anything except that which Allah has decreed for you. And if the whole world was to collaborate to harm you, they will not harm you except with that which Allah has decreed for you. So keep your aqidah and belief correct and put your trust upon in Allah, rely upon Allah and trust Him for all your affairs. This is the meaning of استعين بالله and إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. Only you do we worship and from only you do we seek help. So as for seeking help in other matters which are permitted, which people can help, then that is allowed. For example, you say, please give me a glass of water, help me with this, help me carry this load, there is no harm in that. And if there was someone in a high position and you needed their help, like from the teacher or the dean of the college or from the solicitor or in the court, then you can't say, I need your help, please help me in this manner, because these are matters among the creation and we can help one another in such affairs, so there is no harm in there. But with regards to matters which are only in Allah's control, we should seek only Allah's help and we should not ask anyone to say, give me a child, give me a job and remove my problem, remove my musibat. If whether they are alive or dead, don't go to the qabr and say, give me a child and give me this and give me that, because even though they might be awliyaullah of their time, but they were awliyaullah and they were good people, they have gone to the hereafter. We can say to Allah, O Allah, bless us because of the barakat of this wali of Allah, and the help is sought from Allah. But Allah, just as we take wasila of our a'mal, we can take wasila of ashkhas and afrad as well and say, O Allah, like in the story of the hadithul ghar, the three persons said, gave wasila of their good a'mal and Allah accepted the dua. So similarly, wasila of good persons, that oh Allah, due to the barakat of so and so, Rasulullah ka wasta, tere peghambaron ka wasta, tere Quran Pak ka wasta, due to your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, due to your Kalam Pak, due to your Asma-i Husna, and due to your Awliyaullah, due to your great servants, oh Allah, please do this for us. Then this help is sought from Allah. But we need to get to Allah and we say to Allah, please, because of your rahmat and mercy, please do this for us. There is no harm in there. Some people, go to great length and say, this is shirk, that is shirk, this is bidat, and they class this as bidat as well, whereas, this is totally wrong. They are in illusion. They don't know their deen properly. That's why they make such claims. This is in the hadith. In the hadith wherein Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the blind sahabi, Allahumma inni atawajjahu ilayka bi nabiyyika Muhammadin nabiyyir rahmati, ya Muhammad inni atawajjahu bika ila rabbik litashfa alayhi hadhi fi hajati hadhi, Allahumma fashaffihhu fiyya waqdi hajati. And the sahabi's dua was accepted and his eyesight was restored. So he said, O Allah, I turn to you and I do my tawajjuh to you through your Nabi Muhammad, the Nabi of rahmah. So through someone, you ask Allah, there is no harm in there. So the asking should be from Allah. This is the meaning of إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Allah, you only do we worship. We don't worship any grave or any wali or anyone. And we don't want to seek help from anyone. We only seek help from you. And then إِهْدِنَ الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Guide us along the straight path. Hidayat means الدلالة على ما يوصل إلى المطلوب and الدلالة الموصلة إلى المطلوب. It means both things. To show someone the way, like if I was to ask you where is so and so place and you say go straight, turn right, turn left and after 100 yards it will come. So you've shown me the way. And this is also hidayat, guiding someone. But it also means to go along with someone. You know, I ask you, where is this? And you say, come on, I will take you. And you come with me to that place. So both are hidayat and guidance to show the way and to carry someone along the way. So over here, ihdinas sirat al-mustaqim, it means both things. O Allah, show us the way as well. And O Allah, help us along that way as well. And you take us and guide us. And this, you know, with this explanation, we can understand why we have to say this dua when, we have been guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, Allah Pak has guided us. So then why do we have to keep on making this dua every day when we are Muslims, we are on hidayat? So the explanation is that even though we are Muslims, alhamdulillah wa shukrulillah, but we need Allah's help and guidance each and every moment, every second we need Allah with us. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said in the dua, Allahumma la takilni ila nafsi tarfat ayn. O Allah, do not hand me over to my ego for a blink of an eye. Always be with me, always protect me, guide me, help me, assist me. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught Hazrat Ali the dua, Allahumma ghfir li warhamni wa'afini wahdini warzuqni. And when a person would embrace Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would teach him these five duas. He said to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, O Ali, say, make dua, Allahumma ahdini wa saddidni, wadhkur bil hidayati hidayataka at-tariq wa bis sidadi sidada sahmi. So we need hidayat all the time. So we say, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. O Allah, guide us along sirat al-mustaqim. Keep us and help us along sirat al-mustaqim. And sirat al-mustaqim, the straight path. There is no crookedness in it. There is no exit in it. And it's a straight path which takes a person right unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wusul in Allah, gets to Allah, gets to the pleasure of Allah. And this path takes a person to the place which holds the pleasure of Allah. And that is Jannat, inshallah, Jannatul Firdaus. That is where this path is heading. And we want to stay on this path and we don't want to make any exits and get off this highway or motorway and go hither, thither, here and there. We want to stay on this path. And oh Allah, we need your help to stay on As-Sirat al-Mustaqim. Ihdina As-Sirat al-Mustaqim. Guide us along the straight path. And what is the straight path? It's mentioned in many places. You know, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his duty has also been said that وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. O Muhammad, you guide people towards صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Allah said regarding Quran, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمٍ. This Quran also guides people to that path which is the most straight. So Quran guides, Rasulullah guides, Allah himself guides, and we have been given this guidance upon this straight path which leads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the definition of straight path, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Sirat al-ladhina an'amta alayhim, the path of those upon whom your in'am was done, whom you favored, whom you blessed. And who are these people whom Allah blessed? Allah explained this in Surah An-Nisa. أولئك الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. Those whom Allah favored are the Nabis, the Prophets, the Siddiqeen, the truthful ones, the Shuhada, and the Salihin. And they are the most fitting companions. So صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, when we combine both ayats and Quran يفسر بعضه بعضا, part of Quran explains the other part. So Surah Nisa's ayat will explain this ayat of Surah Al-Fatiha, that صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم means صراط النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. نبيين are finished. Nabuwat is completed upon the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So there will be no more Nabis. So we will have Siddiqeen, Shuhada and Salihin in every era. So we ask Allah to keep us on the path of the prophets on which the prophets went and upon which the Siddiqeen, Shuhada, Salihin were going. And in every era, the Salihin and the Shuhada and the Siddiqeen go. We want to stay on that path. We want to be in this company. These are our companions. These are our elders. And these are, you know, the great legends. And we want to stay with them. This is Sirat al-Ladina namta alayhim. So this also means, you know, Allah didn't say over here Sirat al-Quran or Sirat al-Sunnah, Sirat al-Hadith. Allah says Sirat al-Ladina namta alayhim. So in every era there will be Mun'am alayhim. There will be the Anbiya, there will be the Ulama and the Sulaha and the Mashayikh and you know, those who are the heirs and the inheritors of the Anbiya. Al-Ulama warathatul Anbiya. And the Ulama are qualified and they know the deen properly. So we have to stay attached and close to our Ulama, learn from them, benefit from them, and stay on the path of the Ulama and the Salaha and the Mashayikh and Ahlullah. And this is Sirat al-Ladina namta alayhim. And ghayril maghdubi alayhim waladdallin, not the path of those upon whom your wrath fell and who went astray. Al-Maghdubi alayhim and waladdallin has been mentioned in one hadith as the Yahud and the Nasara. This hadith is in Tirmizi. Qazi Bayzawi has narrated this. At the same time, Qazi Bayzawi mentioned a very good point. He said that, you know, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that al-maghdubu alayhim and al-dallin are al-yahud wa al-nasara, then he is not restricting this tafsir to them. He is only giving an example of those who are included in al-maghdubu alayhim and al-dallin. And then he explains that Allah's ghazab and wrath descends upon those who go astray from the right path deliberately. He explains that a person can lose Sirat-e-Mustaqim by only two ways: deliberately, intentionally, or by mistake. You were going on the highway, motorway, and you deliberately exited. Or you wanted to go on there, but you made a mistake and took the wrong exit and got off on the wrong junction and you ended up on the wrong place. So these are the only two ways of losing the way. So Allah's ghazab fell upon those who deliberately went off track. And they are al-Yahud. Not all Yahud. Because there are many Yahud in the time of Musa alayhi salam who were good people, the followers of Musa alayhi salam, the Sahaba of Musa alayhi salam, the Hawariyin, the good people, and they will be rewarded on the day of Qiyamah. They were nice, pious people, and you know, their quotes are mentioned. However, in every community, there will be some rogue, some sharirs, and who will do wrong things, and they are the ones who towards whom the indication over here is. And waladdallin, dalal means to exit unknowingly by mistake. And this was more common among the Nasara. And same here as well. Not all Nasara. The Hawariyin of Isa alayhi salam and those who, you know, who held on to the deen of Isa alayhi salam properly, they were good people. They are not dalin. So those who made mistakes and who added and subtracted within their deen and religion and whose intention was good, but the intention was good but the method was wrong, and this is dalal and gumrahi and you know, going astray. So those people who went astray, the indication is towards most many among the Nasara who had good intentions but lost the track. So in every era there will be such people. Even in this day and age today in the Muslim community, we will have good people alhamdulillah, and we will have also some people who deliberately go off track and who don't want to practice upon Islam and who deliberately, you know, object upon Islam, deliberately lose the track. And there will be people who are innocent, naive, but due to their naivety, they exit the path of Sirat al-Mustaqim and they go wrong here and there. Their intentions might be to do good, but they are not behaving in a proper manner. They are mistaken. You know, for example, they go to some qabr and make things they shouldn't be doing, or you know, may invent some bid'at or things like that. This is dalal. So ghazab maghzub alayhim dalin in every era. It's not only restricted to the community towards which whom Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam indicated, but they will be present in every era. So we are Allah Pak has taught us that ask Allah to keep that. Oh Allah, we need your help to stay on Sirat al-Mustaqim, and we don't want to go on the path of those upon whom your wrath fell, upon whom your azab came, and we don't want to go on the path of those who went who lost the track, who lost the plot, who went off track by mistake, unintentionally. We want to avoid both things, and we need your help to stay on Sirat al-Mustaqim. This is the meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha. And when we finish this dua, it is sunnah to say Ameen. And Ameen means, Ya Allah, please accept our dua. If'al fi'la al-ijaba. In the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Qasamtu salata bayni wa bayni abdi nisfain wa li abdi ma sa'al. That I have divided salah, which means Surah Fatiha, in two parts. One is for my servant and other is for me. When the servant says Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Hamidani Abdi. When he says Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replies Athna Alayya Abdi. When he says Maliki Yawmiddin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Majjadani Abdi. When he says Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'een, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Haza Bayyaka.